Got to hear the words was my daughter invited me to church, and I just wanted to go just so she would just love my daughter, so I'm going to just do that. And this guy was just preaching, and these words really sunk deep into my heart to where when I went back out of town to work, I took my Bible with me. And then as I was sitting there in the motel room, I was just sitting there reading those words that he was just talking about, and it was God's words, and they were just sinking into my heart. And that is the moment that it's like the light came on, and I realized that I had been far, far away from God, and that I needed to go back, and He wanted me to come back, and He was telling me where I was, that He loved me and He cared about me. And so that was where I had my aha moment. So in that, when I came across this series, I was just like, man, you know what? Everybody really has an aha moment. Everybody does. I don't care who you are. You know, some of them may have not have happened yet, but, you know, some of them have, and some of them have many of them, you know. They get an aha, they come back, and they leave, you know. But they're fortunate that they get that, you know. So we kind of looked at last week, and we started off was, we're doing this based on a study from the book of Luke in chapter 15, is where Jesus is telling the story about the prodigal son. That's where this dad and his two sons, well, the younger son decides to come up to his dad and say, look, you know what, dad, I really wish you was dead, because I want your money that you owe me for when you're dead, you know, and I want to go do my thing. And so the dad doesn't really, you know, he really doesn't say anything back to him. He goes ahead and gives his money. Now, there was this doctor who does a lot of study on that culture, and he was asked the question, have you ever heard of that ever done? And he says, yeah, twice. First off, the son got taken out back and beaten to death. You know, it was really beat really bad because of the way he spoke to his father. The other one was that the father gave him his money, and then within 3 months the father died. So it's the idea of thinking that it's never really heard of that a son would come in and say, you know, dad, I really wish you were dead. I want my inheritance that you're going to give me when you do die so I can go off and do my thing. You know, so it was really, and in that, it was just being very disrespectful to his father. And so the thought of it is that when we go to read the scripture and kind of look at it, we're breaking it down into some things to really see aha, what aha means, and where is it to us? What does it have to do with us? So we're going to read in what we read a little bit last week, and then we're going to add a verse to it right now. All right, so in Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 13, we're going to read. It says, then he, this is Jesus speaking, says, then he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided them his livelihood, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. Okay, so what we see here is what we looked at last week was he left the father's house, and then we kind of looked at what was the father, what is the representation of the father, and that was for us to see that the father represents God, and that at one point or another, that everyone at some time in their lives, they leave God. Why do they leave God? Many different reasons. Some people leave God because, I mean, my excuse that I use was, you know, the preacher did my family wrong, they did my mom and dad wrong, if that's what church is all about, and the preacher's going to treat people like that, I'm better off just hanging out with my friends that we're getting high together, because they're nicer and kinder to each other, because, you know, hey man, can I get a hit off of that? And yeah, they're sharing, they're kind, you know, they're being loving and caring to each other, you know, hey man, can I have a beer? Yeah, help yourself. You know, but at the church, they're bad-mouthing and they're stabbing each other in the back and they're calling each other, you know, and they're kind of isolating people, you know, and they're getting in their little cliques, you know. If that's what church is all about, forget it, I'm out. And a lot of people have their reasons of why they left God. I'm mad at God he didn't heal my mama from cancer and she died, and I love my mama so much. You know, well, your mama loved God, and that she's better off with Jesus, because this place really stinks sometimes anyways. Because of all the evil that is always trying to do people wrong. I mean, somebody could be so kind to you and loving, and on the other hand, they're at home thinking of a way to stab you in the back. You will give them the shirt off of your back and do everything you can for them, and the next thing you know, the police are standing at the door wanting to serve you a warrant. For what you do? I just went over to their house. Now you got a warrant for trespassing. Well, what's that got to do with anything? Or how about this? You know, you did something and they're taking out. I mean, there's just something always going on that's trying to bring harm or hurt. This place really sometimes, that's why it stinks. But here's the thing about it is, it's not God's fault. But people blame God for it. That's the sad thing about it. And in that, when they blame God for it, they leave God. So in there's always something that people are thinking about. It is the Father's house that we're living with and that we're leaving the Father's house. This is where the beginning of the story of Aha begins. And every person's life is leaving the Father's house. There's many representations of it for like my house or my mom and dad's house. As we were growing up, you know, it's like, you know, there's a point in life, yes, there is a time for our children to grow up and move out of the house. But there is also the idea of growing up, amen, thank you, Jesus, yeah. But it's the idea of leaving the right way. The right way of leaving is still having a relationship with the father and mom in the house. Where in a lot of ways, when the child leaves and then there's no relationship, that means they're doing something that mom and dad would not look highly upon, as in it's going to give mom and dad a bad name because I'm doing the wrong things. And so, you know what? I'm just going to cut the ties and I'm going to leave mad and I'm taking my stuff with me. It's almost the same thing as what this story starting off with. He's going, you know, Dad, give me my half of the inheritance and I'm leaving. You know, because why? And their mindset is that I'm going to go do something that it's not what you taught me what was right to do. It's I'm going to go do something because I want to do it. And we're going to look at that here in a little bit, you know, because here's the thing about it. Parents, grandparents, they tell you not to do that. Don't have sex before marriage. They say that. Don't do drugs. They don't go get drunk. Don't do this. They say all this don't stuff. But they forget to tell you about the time when they did it and the fun, the absolute fun they had doing it. But that's the idea. In the moment it's fun, but the consequences after that is horrific. That's why they're saying don't do that. Because of the consequences. For many, it was from that point of after getting that first drink on, they became alcoholics. That first time they smoked that joint, they became drug addicts. They had the issues in life is why mom and dad said, don't do that. But here's the child that grows up and says, I'm just going to do what I want to do. I'm tired of mom and dad telling me what to do. See, God wrote this book with some instructions. He called them laws. Why did he do that? To keep us safe. Because he knew that the sin of this world had great consequences and even death. That it would bring death. And I have been at many funerals where death was from the consequences of sin that they had done earlier in their life. The drug addiction killed them. The sex outside of marriage gave them diseases, killed them. Just not eating right and just living a wild life brought on cancer, killed them. Driving down the road, doing what they were not supposed to be doing, crashed, died. And all this is just God saying, I have a purpose for you. So that's why I have rules in my house for you to follow, to keep you safe, to fulfill the purpose that I have for you to do. And we get in this selfish, self-minded idea saying, I'm going to do things my way. I'm tired of what Dad's telling me to do. I'm out of here. So they leave and they go to a distant country. Somewhere that I ain't got to look Dad in the face and feel guilty about what I did. Or even try to hide it. Because I'm on my own now. I'm a big person. But see, you know, there's adults that still think that way, you know? They still think and act that way. So, part of an aha moment story is not just leaving the father's house, but is going to a distant country. It's going to a distant land. So it looks a little like this. When it says that he wasted his possessions with prodigal living, it's this. The distant country will leave you broke. A lot of times we will find ourselves in a position of getting away from Dad, who took care of us all our lives, who spent thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars to raise us. Daddy, I need a new pair of Nikes. Boy, I just bought you Nikes 3 months ago. Well, got a hole right there.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. Let's go try some on. Okay, maybe we'll get out. And what we're doing is we're slapping God in the face. We're slapping our Father in the face, saying, I don't want you to take care of me no more. I'm going to do it myself. And then we take everything that God has given us, and we go out and we partied up. Because imagine this. Imagine when you was 18, or maybe you're getting to be 18. Okay, what an 18-year-old does with all that money. Woo, you know, hey, I got a new friend, you know, my new friend, it's my new friend. You know, do you like my new friend? And you only know your friend knows he's there. Their purpose is you got money, and they can mooch off of you, and they're going to get everything they can get. Let's go party. Let's go to the club. Let's go to go. Hey, man, won't you buy a beer? I don't know. I don't really drink. Just try it. Just try it. You'll like it. You'll have a blast, you know, because it's the idea of thinking. We forget that sin is fun for a moment. You know, that's one of the reasons when we turn 18, we're looking to get out on our own, is we're looking to have some fun, because there's no fun at Dad's house. It's so boring. We sit in here playing the Xbox all the time. It's so boring. And watch the Netflix over and over. You know, once in a while we go on vacation for a week. You know, it's so boring. I'm so bored sitting here all the time. It's just life. I want to go out and have some fun on my own. That's our thought. That's why we do what we do. And what does it do? It's all about me, 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 me. Selfish, selfish, selfish. We forget. We have ties to family. We have the mom who poured out sweat and blood raising you, making sure you got to school on time, make sure you got good grades, make sure that dad brought enough money home to make sure you had nice clothes on and you looked presentable to go anywhere, that you were not an embarrassment. And the mom who stayed up with you night after night when you was sick, throwing up, cleaning up, holding your hair back while you was over the toilet, just giving all your guts out. You know, it's those times that you're forgetting about the mom who poured into you and poured into you her life. So that when you did go out on your own, you would be successful. You would be a good attribute and contribution to society. And you wouldn't be an embarrassment to her or yourself. Selfishness. And you're just thinking, I'm going to the distant land. I don't need that anymore. I'm going to do it myself. So maybe the squandering of all they had in their livelihood, it wasn't always maybe that the money that they lost. Maybe it was, maybe you wouldn't have lost the wealth. Maybe you would have lost your reputation. Reputation means a lot. A name means a lot. Especially when it comes to a job interview or somebody to help you out in life. You know, I mean, if it's somebody's like, I need some help, I want to do this, I want to do that, so could you help me? I'm like, oh, you got a bad name for yourself, I ain't getting involved with you. Reputation means a lot. It may not have been wealth that was lost, but it might have been your family. You might have burnt the bridge because you hurt your family so bad. They're done with you. There are a lot of families that are like that, that have a point in their lives. You know what? You've stole from me. You have done this to me. You have said bad things about me. I don't care if I gave birth to you. I'm done with you. You hurt the family that bad. How about this? It may not have been wealth that you've lost, but it might be that you have lost trust. You've lied after lie after lie after lie. Nobody trusts you. How about maybe if you may not have been wealth that you've lost, but it might have been your job. Sometimes when you're out there partying so much that you're having so much fun, you forgot to go to work the next day because you're laying in the bed all still high from the night before. And all of a sudden, next thing you come into work the next day, and they said, well, this is the third time this month. We've done wrote you up twice. Here's your papers. You're done. You're fired. You see, I kind of have this little story. You know, last week we kind of watched this little video clip of this one. She was a waitress and her daddy owned it. And I don't think I finished the story of what happened to her, you know. But in that, she got that, she wanted to go to college to be a doctor. And she was accepted to this college. But dad didn't have enough money because the restaurant didn't make enough money to help her go through college. She couldn't get the grants and things that she needed to go to. So this guy offers a job as to be a stripper at this place to make $500 a day, you know, and she's like, yeah, I can do that. And then she gets hooked up into this crowd of people, and then there's drugs involved, and then all of a sudden is at the point of that the guy starts using, manipulating her and thinking she's trash and she's worthless, you know, and ends up she's not making the money, and the lifestyle that she thought was going to be so great doesn't turn out to be. And then that she starts to walk out, and the guy that he really thinks he owns her now slams her up against the wall and tells her to her face. He says, your daddy's not going to take you back when you go back to him. You're disgusting, and you're filthy, and you're nasty. You're worthless, and your daddy won't take you back. All to manipulate her to think that she was worthless and she had to stay in that job because he had to hold on her, and the money was the thing that was the motivator to keep her where she was. And she says, I'm going to try anyways. My daddy, I know my daddy loves me. And he walks away. And she goes back to her dad and tells him, listen, I made some bad choices and I'm so sorry. He does nothing. He does nothing but hug her and tell her he loves her. And then he turns around and he throws a party. Now, she has an older sister, and over in the background, she's kind of a little mad because she's been running the show as the waitress, head waitress, and everything like that, and now the little sister's back, you know. And it's a perfect picture of what Jesus is trying to tell. But here's another story. There's a lady, she's in a marriage, you know, and her husband's in the routine. He fell into the routine of life. Go to work, get up, go to work, raise my daughter, take care of my family, come home, sit down, watch TV, watch the big game, go hang out with the guys, you know, once a month, thing like that. And the affection of the marriage falls apart, and the woman feels like he doesn't love her anymore. And all of a sudden, one day, she's just not happy in the marriage, and she runs across this dude at the counter getting coffee, and she went to school with, and she had a crush on him when she was in school. Ooh. Oh, what are you doing? Oh, I'm doing this. Oh, you know. Oh, did you get married? And she lies. I'm not married. Just to keep holding the conversation because he's looking at her a certain way and complimenting her. Or her husband has stopped doing that because he's got into the routine just thinking everything is good. She knows I love her. And he doesn't tell her that. And all of a sudden she's saying, I'm done with this marriage. I want something more out of it. I want something more, most out of it. And one day they're sitting, she lies to her husband and says she's going to go somewhere, and she meets this guy, and they're sitting around this little pool area, and they're having this giggly conversation, and the butterflies are happening, and oh, it's so nice, it's so wonderful, this guy's paying me attention, he loves me, he cares about me. And she's takes the step. You want to go upstairs? And the affair begins. She's lying to her husband, and she's making preparations to leave him. And then out of that, she does leave him. And then as soon as she leaves him, the guy says, this is not really what I want. I'm done. And he leaves her. Now, she has went to the distant country thinking she's going to get what she thought was better for her, and now she's alone. She's broke. Some of the choices that we make sometimes are so selfish and inconsiderate. Now she's hurt her family. She's hurt her daughter. She's caused a preparation of divorce. And now, not alone, maybe the conversations that she's had with her friends and her mom and dad, they're all involved in this. Going to the distant country will bring such pain and brokenness. Let me read you Luke chapter 15, verse 14 through 16. It says this. It says, but when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods of the swine, what the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. It will leave you in a point of desperation. You will do anything. See, the culture of that time for this guy here is the Jewish person. Swine are dirty. Pigs are dirty. They're not to have anything to do with pigs. It's against their culture. Now he's in a position, he's feeding what the pigs are, a part of his, it's going to be his job trying to survive. He's willing to eat what they're eating. That's bad. That's bad. But it all came back to, it's my life. It was my choice. I wanted to do these things. Maybe it was once your new fling is over and you're realizing you're all alone. Maybe for some people it was the idea of the corporate ladder. If I just take this job and make more money, and I can do this and I can do that, I can provide for my family. And then what you end up doing, you spend more time at the job, and then you miss raising your kids. Been there. Then you have no relationship with your kids, and so then when your kids do turn 17 and 18 and start to get their mind of their own, that there's no connection there for you to input into their life to make right choices. And they're saying, fooey with you, Dad. You weren't around anyways. What does it matter what I do? Because you didn't care. Because you chose to go up that corporate ladder and not spend any time, quality time, with your family. The distant country will leave you alone. You see, sin had this really cool saying, and I lost it. Sin will take you farther than you want to go. I lost the highlight on it. That's what the problem was. I guess I wasn't supposed to say it, eh? There was a TV show called Intervention. There were people that had issues with life, drug addictions, alcoholism, things like that, gambling issues, stuff like that. And the family and friends would get involved to say, hey, listen, you're in a place that is bad. It is self-destructive, and you're fixing to lose everything, and we want to help you get back. But see, the idea in this is also a picture to realize to them, to say, look at what you've done to hurt not just you, but to hurt the whole family that's trying to come to you and say, hello, we love you, but we're done. Unless you do something now. One of the things was says one sister said to her brother, all I wanted was to be around by my big brother. Things are different now. I've gone from always wanting to be in your presence to be fearful of being alone in the same room with you. One son said to his father, said, Dad, if I had one wish, I would wish that you would get better. Please get better for our family. See, the distant country is a place that is absolutely everybody hurts. I mean, sure, the story was all about the father. But what about the mom who spent so much time raising the son? What about the brother who was watching this his brother hurt his dad and saying what he did? It's not just you that's hurting now. You're in a distant country and you've lost everything. God is trying to say to you today, I know you're in a bad place. Come home. He said to Saul, you know, for Saul, his story was that he was having Christians killed. So he was in a bad place. But that day, he met with Jesus on the road. It took a flash of light and blind him. To open his understanding of how much God loves him and where he was at is not a good place. So the question for you right now is to ask you, where you're at is not a good place. And what will it take for God to talk to you, to say to you, where you're at is not a good place. I want you to come home. For some, it's going to be a whisper. There was a king in Chronicles, 2 Chronicles 34. It was him to sit down and have the word read to him that he realized that the whole country needed to go back to God. And that was just the word that was read. Maybe it's something tragic like Saul, that you have to be physically hurt to find out that you're in the wrong place and God wants you to come back home. See, really, this aha story that we're studying for the next several weeks is really based upon Christians who have it in their mind, they're saved and they're going to heaven, but they're not living for God and they're not sold out for God and they're away from God in their relationship, that they don't get up every morning and talk to Him and read about Him and listen to Him and have this communication, have this relationship. They're far from God and God's saying, woo, come home. I love you. I know you're mad at me. Or I know that this has happened. But come home. Come home. Every story has a beginning. But no other story ends like God's story. For an aha story something bad is happening in your life. And then a light will come on and you'll realize that God isn't the bad guy here. He's the one that's saying, it was good at my house, come back. It was good at my house, come back. Maybe it's the idea and God's trying to say to you in His loving way, I'm whispering to you, I love you, come home. In Ephesians chapter 5, Paul writes this. He says, wake up, old sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Man, that right there is so inspiring to me. Wake up, old sleeper. I mean, can you not look around us and the things that are happening with the decisions our country is making by the leaders and watching Israel and watching the conflict is having? ISIS is taking no mercy and killing Christians and the things that are happening around us. The world is starting to get out of control. And God is saying, wake up, oh sleeper. You Christians that are far away, come home. Let's get strong in backing God's family. Because you don't want to be out there alone when it really hits the fan. You want to be in God's arms and in His strength for when it hits the fan. Because when I read the Revelations, God's Word is true. What He predicted that before Jesus came happened and Jesus came, and now He's predicting what is going to happen when Jesus comes again. It's going to happen again. It's going to happen again for Jesus to come again. Wake up, O sleeper. O Christian that have left Dad's house. Dad is saying, I love you, come home. He's standing on the porch and He's calling to you, come home, come home. If God would say, if He was standing right in front of your face right now, He would say to you, come home. I love you, come home. I don't care what's happened in your life. I don't care what you've done. I don't care. I love you. Come home. 1 John 4:10 says, it's not that we loved Him first. It's that He loved us first. That He gave His Son to die for us. To cleanse us from our bad deeds. Our sin against Him. Our sin against others. Our sin against ourselves. Jesus came not to condemn us. He came to set us free. He came to wash us from our sin. He came to restore the relationship that His Father, our Father, wants back with us. As we close in prayer, you'll bow your heads. Everyone is going through their own journey of life right now. You could be a really good Christian, but God wants you to be better. You could be a Christian that's so far away, but God wants you to pull you in closer. It's the object of our life is not to be still or going backwards, it's to be moving forward. Forward till it's time to leave this earth and go home. But He's reaching out and He's saying, I know you're in a bad place and people are lying to you that you're worthless, you're no good, you can't go back, He won't accept you, and I'm here to tell you today, it's a lie. Come back home. Don't believe that person who's whispering in your ear, you're worthless, you're no good. God's saying, I have a purpose for you. Come. Come. Come home. Now is the time to come home. So as we pray, I'm asking you, will you surrender all and make God and Jesus not just Savior, but make Him Lord? put him back as king over your life. And whoever else is king over your life, dethrone them. Dethrone the job. Dethrone the man. Dethrone the woman. Dethrone the item that is king. And put Jesus back in his kingship place. And the Father, I'm asking you to pray that right now. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just praise you and worship you and honor you and glorify your name, for you are holy and righteous. Your mercy endures so awesome. Your grace, wonderful. But I ask now, forgive us from our sins that we have wandered away from you, from the house. We want to come back. Father, right now, will you reach down from heaven and will you wrap your arms around us and love us? We thank you for sending Jesus to be our Savior, but more than that, we thank you for him reuniting us in a relationship. We bless your holy name. Father, right now there's going to be somebody who's going to be watching online, Lord, and they're going to need to know when they're praying to you that you're hearing them. And I'm asking for a special way that they will know it's you. It's you that's reaching and loving them where they are. Send that warmth over their heart. Send that peace in their mind. And send them a visual way to get out, away from that's what's holding them. That person who thinks that they got them in that place, that they can't get away from that person. Show them a way out, Lord. Show them a way out. Financially, show them a way out. Show them a way where to stay, Lord. Move in a mighty way because you love them. I bless them in the name of Jesus with freedom. I bless them with your love and your peace and your grace. In Jesus' name, amen.